Good evening, church. We welcome you all to this evening service in this Passion Week. Let's look unto the Lord in prayer. Our Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day, for this time. Thank you, Father God, that you've given us the blessing of seeing another day, Lord. Lord, even at this time, as we have come to meditate on your word, to lift your name, and to remember you in this crucial time, remember your sacrifice, remember what you've done for us. We pray, Father God, that you'll be with us, that you'll speak to us, and that you'll work in our life. Lord, cleanse us, prepare us, and we pray, Father God, that whatever we offer to you will be pleasing in your sight. In the name of Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Let's all rise up and praise the one who's a strong tower in our life, and lift him up for that. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord Most High. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord Most High. The name of the Lord. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it, and they are saved. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it, and they are saved. He's holy. Holy is the name of the Lord. Holy is the name of the Lord. Holy is the name of the Lord Most High. Holy is the name of the Lord. Holy is the name of the Lord. Holy is the name of the Lord Most High. The name of the Lord. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. Righteous running. They are saved. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it, and they are saved. All glory belongs to Him. Glory to the name of the Lord. Glory to the name of the Lord. Glory to the name of the Lord.
Run into it, and they are saved.
to him anytime. In the book of Romans, we see Paul painting a beautiful picture of God's plan of salvation. How God, from the beginning, he saw the brokenness of mankind, and he always had the plan of salvation. The plan of salvation through grace and through mercy. And in view of that, having painted the beautiful architect of God's plan, he then starts the chapter 12 by saying, "Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship." Let's all just close our eyes at this time and just adore the grace of God. Adore God's mercy in our life. Adore the beautiful plan of God's salvation. And just tell them that, "Lord, we belong to you. We offer our lives unto you as a living sacrifice. We daily give our lives unto you, O God. We live for you. You are our everything, O Lord. We thank you for your Son. We thank you for your salvation. We thank you, Father God, that your Son came to serve us. And today we offer ourselves to you, O Lord." From heaven you came, helpless babe. Entered our world, your glory veil. Not to be served, but to serve. And give your life that we might live. Let's sing it again. From heaven you came, helpless babe. Entered our world, your glory veil. Not to be served, but to serve. And give your life that we might live. This is our God, the servant king. He calls us now to follow. The daily offering of worship to the servant king.
There in the garden of tears, my heavy load you chose to
our God, the servant king. He calls us now to follow him, to bring our lives as a daily offering of worship to the servant king. Come see his hands and his feet, the scars that speak of sacrifice, hands that flung stars into space, two cruel nails surrendered. This is our God, the servant king.
calls us now to follow Him, to bring our lives as a daily offering, all worship to the servant King. So let us learn how to serve, and in our lives enthrone Him. Each other's needs to prefer, for it is Christ we are serving. This is our God, the servant King. He calls us now to follow Him, to bring our lives as a daily offering, all worship to the servant King. This is our God, this is our God, the servant King. He calls us now to follow Him, to bring our lives as a daily offering, all worship to the servant King, all worship to the servant King. We worship you, O Lord, for all you have done. We worship you, O Lord, we worship you, our King. We worship you, O Lord, for your Son. We worship you, we worship you, we worship you, O Lord, for all you have done, for your Son, for all you have done. We worship you, O Lord, our King, our King, our King. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich, because of what the Lord has done for us. And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich, because of what the Lord has done for us. For all you have done,
Let's just give thanks to Him for all that He has done, for the salvation, for His Son, for the strength that He gives. For we who are poor, He has made us rich. Let's just give Him thanks.
Give thanks to You for all You have done, for all You have done, for all You have done. We give thanks to You for Your forgiveness, for Your mercy, and for Your love. We give thanks to You for Your Son and for His blood and for Your grace. We give thanks to You for all You have done and for Your love, O God, for Your love. We give thanks to You for all You have done, for Your salvation. We give thanks to You. We give thanks to You for Your Son, for Your mercy, and for Your love. Let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am great. Because of what the Lord has done for us. And now, let the weak, the poor say, I am weak, because of what the Lord has done for us. Give thanks. Oh, we give thanks. We give thanks. We give thanks.
Even if we give all that we have, it would still not match when compared to what You have done for us, God. In this Passion Week, as we begin to ponder on what You have done for us through Christ, this evening, God, our hearts are filled with gratitude. None of us who's here right now, who's watching online, none of us deserve it. And yet, because You're a gracious God, You sent Your Son. For God so loved the world. What a word it is, God. For God so loved us, that You gave Your only begotten Son. That just by believing in Him, that none of us can perish but have eternal life. That is the hope we have this evening, God. That is the reason why we worship You. We offer everything back to You and give thanks to You. Thank You, God, for this evening, and thank You for the opportunity to worship You throughout this week as we gather together as Your body, as Your family, as Your children. Would You continue to reveal Yourself more and more to us, God, as we ponder on the grace of God. Looking at the cross, may You, God, begin to work deep within those areas in our lives that are still yet to be reconstructed. transformed. I pray that God, that you would touch those areas. And some of us may feel uncomfortable. And yet it is good that you make us uncomfortable and then change our lives so that we can be made like Christ. That is your will for us, God, and we thank you that you gave us such an opportunity this evening. And we pray that, God, as we pay attention to you, would you take capture our thoughts? Would you take control of our lives, our bodies, God? In your presence, may we begin to rest and receive. Thank you, and we bless you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Remain standing as you gather this evening. Would you like to take your Bibles? And I'm hoping, can you switch on the lights in the hall so we can read the scripture that is dedicated for this evening, and we will meditate on it. We will look at Luke chapter 5 today. Luke chapter 5, verses 27 onwards. We will read verses 27 to 32 and spend some time meditating on this scripture. Later, as Jesus left the town, he saw a tax collector named Levi sitting at his tax collector's booth. "Follow me and be my disciple," Jesus said to him. So Levi got up, left everything, and followed him. Later, Levi held a banquet in his name, in his home, with Jesus as the guest of honor. Many of Levi's fellow tax collectors and other guests also ate with them. But the Pharisees and their teachers, the teachers of religious law, complained bitterly to Jesus' disciples. "Why do you eat and drink with such scum?" Jesus answered them, "Healthy people don't need a doctor. Sick people do. I have come to call not on those who think they are righteous, but those who know they are sinners and need to repent." You may be seated. From yesterday, we began talking about the table at which Jesus chose to minister. We talked about the table ministry of Jesus. It plays a very important role, as much as the healings that he had performed, as much as the teachings that he had given, the travels that he took. The table ministry of Jesus played a very important role in changing the lives of people. Luke specifically took time to talk about that table ministry of Jesus, the table fellowship of Jesus. In fact, it has become a standard norm in the early church that whenever they gathered together, they made sure they gathered around the table. Every single day, not just once in a week, not just occasionally, but every single day they gathered together at the table, spent time in fellowship, in prayer, worship, in teaching and worshiping, in sharing, but most importantly, in communing together. Such was the importance that was given to the table fellowship, because there's something about the table of Jesus that Jesus spreads before us that has the transformative power that changes our lives completely. And Luke talked a lot about it, and we looked at 10 occasions that Luke talks about in his gospel, records in his gospel. And of course, while we are not looking at all 10 of them, we are picking up 7 of them. Starting from yesterday, we looked at one table that Jesus took time to go and sit down with, a guy called Zacchaeus, in chapter 19 of Luke. But we jumped ahead because it lined with Palm Sunday. And also, it kind of gives us the foundational aspect of the grace of God. The table fellowship of God expresses the grace of God. You would see that every conversation that Jesus had at the table is an expression of God's grace. Why am I talking about the grace of God? Why this season? Is because I feel that people either have a misunderstanding of how the grace of God works, have less understanding of the grace of God, or no teaching at all on the grace of God. And so there is it is necessary for us to understand the kind of grace that God specifically has towards man, all of us. And that's the reason why we are talking about the stories of grace that took place around the table, in the words of Jesus, in the way that he affected the lives of people that he sat with, kind of gives us a glimpse into the heart of God for man. And like yesterday when we talked about how his conversation with Zacchaeus paints a picture of the saving grace of God, how the grace of God saves our lives and changes, irrespective of who we are, even if nobody pays attention to us, nobody thinks that we are important, God considers us valuable enough, important enough, that he would make time to come and sit with us, that he would accept us just as we are. There are no preconditions for his, for him to come and have conversations with us or dine with us. And most importantly, he would not leave us the same way that we are. In fact, his grace is such powerful, has such power that it transforms our lives completely, like how it did Zacchaeus' life. And that's what we talked about yesterday, the saving grace of God, and why that grace, only that grace can save us. Only the grace of God can save us. Today, we will look at this story that we have just read, the incident that took place right before the ministry, right in the beginning of Jesus' ministry. When Jesus was calling his disciples, he called one of these guys, tax collectors. Yesterday, the tax collector was somebody who's already in that business. But this is specifically Jesus calling this particular tax collector to become and follow him, become his follower, in fact, to become his disciple. And that's why it's important for us to start off with him and know what Jesus did and why this man left what he was doing so quickly and followed after Jesus. There must be something about that person's calling. And that kind of gives us a glimpse into another aspect of the grace of God, which I want to call restoring grace of God. How the grace of God restores those who have fallen back in their faith. Yesterday, we looked at how the grace of God rescues those who are completely lost. Today, we're going to talk about how the grace of God restores those who have fallen back. Backslidden is what we call it. And that's what I want to talk from Matthew 11. And I tell you why I chose Matthew's table that kind of gives us an understanding of how the restoring grace of God works. All of our relationship, and I'm assuming all of you are Christians, and those who are watching online would be Christians, because who would want to take time at 7 p.m. on a weekday and sit down and receive, except that you must be a Christian, obviously. You already know Christ, and you are following Christ. But just like every other relationship, our relationship with Christ must be maintained every day. Yesterday, I was talking to a few people who were going to take baptism, and I talked about how the baptism itself would not change our lives, but it is our relationship with Christ that changes our lives. Our relationship with Christ has the transformative power, not the baptism in the water. Baptism in the water is just a symbolic expression of our relationship with Jesus Christ. And so, it is our relationship, our walk with God every day that changes us and has the transformative power in our lives. Just like how any other relationship must be maintained with a regular communication, our relationship with Christ must also be maintained like that, with regular communication. That's how we grow closer to God. Just like how a husband and wife, the more they communicate with each other, the more they grow closer to each other. The more they spend time with each other, the more they grow closer to each other. It's the same way with our relationship with God too. When we stop communicating with God, we begin to drift away in our relationship. At some point, our heart grows colder and colder towards that relationship. Instead of growing warmer and warmer towards that relationship, we become more colder in our relationship with God. We become a namesake Christian rather than a following, a Christian who is in a living relationship with God. And I can understand that all of us go through those seasons in our lives. Some of us find the grace of God quicker and get back on our track. But many people, as they drift away from their relationship with God, as their heart grows colder, they become more and more close to God and they start losing their faith slowly. That phase of any Christian's walk, we call it backsliding Christian. There may be many reasons why Christians backslide. Let me give you four common reasons, and you can have multiple other reasons, but I'm just giving you four reasons. One, a Christian can backslide because of overconfidence. You know, there could be possible that some Christians assume that they know enough, they've been Christians for so long, they were born in a Christian home, they grew up in Christian home, they grew around church, they heard so many sermons, they saw so many people who are Christians, but they know, they feel like they already know a lot about Christendom, Christ and church, and therefore they don't really pay attention to their relationship with God because they assume they already know everything. Bible calls that pride, by the way, self-righteousness. I didn't want to use the word self-righteousness, I just wanted to use the word overconfidence for now. Our overconfidence in our own Christian life can sometimes make us backslide in our faith itself. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 32, Paul says, let him who stands take heed lest he falls, he says. If you're standing for Christ, take care of it. That's what he's saying. Make sure you pay attention to your standing in your faith because there's a possibility that you may fall. So he's talking to Christians. He's talking to the church members. And he's saying, listen, I know you're a Christian. I know you're a professing Christian. But there is a possibility that if you become overconfident in your own Christian life, you may fall. There may be some people, because of their overconfidence in their own self-righteousness, may backslide. Some people may backslide simply because they're lazy. Laziness is another reason why a lot of Christians backslide in their faith. You see, living by faith requires discipline, self-discipline. As I told you, it is our relationship with Jesus that shapes our lives. And so, maintaining a relationship with Jesus requires a discipline that we spend time with Him every single day. It requires for us to open our Bibles and read our Bibles, study our Bibles, meditate on it, spend time in prayer with Him, talking to Him, and then practicing what you have learned. It requires commitment and discipline to do that. Sometimes because of the changing circumstances, because of the kind of people we are surrounded by, with, we may feel like, I can do it tomorrow, I can do it tomorrow. You know, we have this YouVersion Bible that kind of gives you the count of how many times you opened the YouVersion and read, right? It's a good incentive. That it kind of tells you the streak that you maintain, how many times you opened actually the YouVersion Bible, the app, in your phone or in your laptop. Sometimes that can become an incentive for us to open the Bible every single day on our phone and read it, so simply because we can earn so many badges. That's a danger in that. There's also a danger that sometimes when we lose the streak, you feel like, no, I can't maintain this, let me just not. This is too much work. Laziness towards our own Christian walk can make us backslide in our relationship with God. Matthew chapter 6, verses 41, Jesus says, watch and pray so that you won't fall into temptation. Watch and pray so that you won't fall into temptation. If you're not watching your Christian walk and spending time in prayer, there's a high possibility that you will fall into temptation. Martin Luther once said like this, that every Christian must go through two things every single day. And he says this, that every Christian must face meditation every day, must also face temptation every day. It's a very interesting thing that he made, that kind of observation. He goes on to explain that. He goes on to say, the reason you need to meditate is that in the meditation, your faith is built up. As you're reading the scripture, as you're spending time with God, because your relationship is getting stronger, your faith builds up. And then you also need to face temptation every day, because when you face temptation, that faith that is built up inside you becomes the weapon with which you face the temptation and defeat it. If you're succumbing to temptation, which you're going to face every single day anyway, that means you did not spend time in meditation. Long before Martin Luther said that, Jesus said this: watch and pray so that you won't fall into temptation. So some people backslide in their faith as Christians because they're simply lazy. Some people backslide because of the fear of disapproval from others. We live in a society that is in diametrically opposite to what we value, what we believe in. And there is nothing we can do about it. You are surrounded by people, live in communities, work with people, study along with people who have a different value system, who believe in different things. And there's a high possibility, and because of our relationship with those people and because of our connections with them and because of what we may be able to gain through them, we feel being a disadvantage simply because we are Christians. And so we kind of compromise on our values for the fear of disapproval from them. Now, I used in general terms like community and friends and colleagues and classmates and all that stuff. But there is a possibility that some of us may be facing that kind of pressure from within our family, from among those who may not be as committed as you are and have the same kind of value system like you do within your own family. And when you face resistance from them, it becomes more difficult for you to maintain your faith and your values. And because of that, fear of disapproval, you may fall away. Proverbs chapter 29 verses 25 says, fearing people is a dangerous trap. If you are afraid of people, you fall into a trap that is very dangerous. That actually is going to become a death knell for us. So as Christians, we must be more afraid of disapproval from God, have the fear of God, not disapproval of God, but have the fear of God than the disapproval of people, so that we can maintain our Christian walk. Then, of course, there's another reason why Christians may fall, and that is simply because walking in faith and living by faith is not convenient for us. It's not something that, that is actually helping us. It, in fact, is pushing us into more troubles, more problems. We just want to have a comfortable faith. We just want to have comfortable stuff. We want all our prayers to be answered. We want all our prayers to be answered the way they want to be. We want them to be answered. We want God to give whatever we want. And when that things don't happen and things are not really comfortable for us, we may simply choose not to follow Jesus. Now, I can go on listing out many more. I just took 4 of them that are most common among people. Now, why am I talking about that when I'm supposed to talk about the table fellowship of Matthew, right? Let's talk about Matthew itself. And why is it important for us to understand the dinner table at Matthew's house is a very important one? If not for anybody else, and Matthew had a lot of guests at his dinner party. If not for anybody else, it was a life-changing moment for Matthew. And I kind of want to paint that picture for you because I think Matthew is a representative of a backsliding Christian. Rather than an unsaved Gentile, Matthew is a symbol of backsliding person. Let me explain that to you. First of all, what we know, the information that we know, is that Matthew is a tax collector. I know Luke says he's Levi, but we know it's Matthew because Matthew talks about himself in his own book, Gospel Matthew chapter 9. So we know it's Matthew's house. We definitely are sure because all the 3 gospel writers mention the same incident. And it's not like two different people who had a similar experience, we would have come to that kind of conclusion that these are two different people with similar kind of experience. Had the conversation of Jesus been different? But the question was the same and the answer was the same. Matthew, Mark and Luke. Matthew chapter 9, Mark chapter 2, Luke chapter 5. Okay? In those three places, you see the same incident. In all those three places, you see exactly the same conversation. Jesus sees this tax collector sitting at the tax collecting booth, calls him out and says, come and follow me. This man leaves everything and follows Jesus. That day, I don't know when he arranged the party, but he did arrange a party at his home and invited fellow tax collectors. You would see exactly the same incident being repeated exactly the same way in all the three gospel writers, in all three gospels. Except that each one mentioned the name differently. Mark and Luke, both in Mark and Luke, he's called a Levi. I'll come to that part a little later. Matthew, of course, talking about the same incident, actually writes his own name there, saying it is my home, basically, Matthew's home. Obviously, he places himself in the story and writes about how the transformation took place in his own personal life as a tax collector. So this particular tax collector, we must look at because he kind of represents a lot of us. Matthew, obviously, is a tax collector. He's a Jew who is a tax collector, just like Zacchaeus, who is a tax collector, a Jew who is a tax collector. And yesterday, I talked about how much Jews hated tax collectors. Especially Jews who are tax collectors. Jews hated them more than the government under which they were in, more than the Caesar who was ruling over them, more than the trouble that they get through Roman soldiers or Syrian soldiers. Jews hated tax collectors because they have this reputation of taking more than what was supposed to be taken, more than what was supposed to be charged. They have the reputation of charging more duty than what was supposed to be laid on in order for their own accumulation of wealth, personal wealth. So basically, all tax collectors are corrupt people. In those days, they used the system that gives them the freedom, which puts people in disadvantage. They used that particular system to turn it into an advantage for them by becoming corrupt. That's why Jews did not like tax collectors. In fact, Jewish people viewed tax collectors as traitors. I was reading the whole issue of tax collecting in those days, in the ancient days. It was told that these tax collectors would charge these exuberant charges over people simply so that they can do whatever they want. The people would be afraid of even to be seen by a tax collector anywhere if their assessment is not done. They have the freedom to walk, stop anybody on the street and search them and seize anything that they find on those people they searched. If that person did not pay tax. Except for women, that too only Roman women, tax collectors can do whatever they want. They can cross-check anybody, they can walk into any house, seize anything that they want, and collect that as a tax as a tax for the government. That's why people feared. They say even in Egypt, as the Roman Empire spread to Egypt too, the tax collectors were so harsh that they would not even mind the age of people. The local women, even if they are old people, they would just beat them up in order for the collection of taxes from among family members. They say in those days when there was a crop failure. And they are supposed to pay tax, irrespective of crop coming up or failing. When the villagers hear that a tax collector is coming to collect the tax, they would by droves leave those villages and find another place to settle down as a village. Leave, entire families would move, simply because they are that afraid of tax collectors. So you can understand the kind of hatred people had for tax collectors. And I can assume the kind of hatred Matthew would have faced living in Capernaum, a very strong Jewish, nationalistic location. The Galilean region was a region known to be a rebellious region, meaning a lot of Jews who lived there are part of some kind of secret movement against a terrorist movement against the Roman government. So Matthew is living right in the middle of people who actually hate Roman government to the core, and he represents the Roman government there, and he is a tax collector. Imagine the kind of life he would have led. At least Zacchaeus had Jericho. Jericho was more of a trade city, so therefore, he had more. It was a city like Hyderabad, so it's kind of everybody is living here, everybody is on their own business and stuff. So maybe the hatred that he would have faced is lesser than what Matthew would have faced in his own life. But that was not my point. My point was that Matthew is not just a tax collector, he's a Levite. That's the focus I want to focus on. He was a Levite. You see what Mark and Luke did? They, instead of calling him by his actual name, they called him by his community, his tribe, the tribe from which he comes from, Levi. His name could have been Matthew Levi. Nobody who's not a Levite would name themselves as a Levi. As an Indian, you would understand what I'm trying to talk about. This is a name for that particular group of people, a tribe that was separated by God in his service. When you read the Old Testament and the way that God specifically gives a lot of instructions to Levites, you would see the kind of priority God placed on Levites. So from among Levites, where Moses and Aaron come from, God chose Aaron's family to be the priests. So anybody who comes out of Aaron's womb, Aaron's ancestry, would become a priest or a chief priest. Only they can become priests and do the priestly service within the temple. But rest of the tribe, the Levitic tribe, are supposed to be in service of God. The more you read the book of Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, even 1 Chronicles and 2 Chronicles kind of list down to us multiple things that Levites are supposed to do. They, except for becoming priests, Levites must take care of everything that is that is regarding spiritual aspects of the nation of Israel. They're supposed to take care of any judicial aspect of the nation of Israel. They're supposed to take care of any kind of legislative aspect of nation of Israel. And they're supposed to take care of any kind of educational aspect of Jewish nation. So basically, these are people who are supposed to be the representatives of God to people and of people to God. That was their job. Their primary job was that. Everybody else is free to do their own works, their own businesses. Only Levites are supposed to do these four areas. Priests, Aaronic family, must take care of the priesthood of the temple. But rest of the Levites are supposed to do all these four. Administrate anything spiritual, anything that is connected with the church, the temple, and the tabernacle. Anything that is to do with the judicial aspects of people, the life of people. Anything that is to do with the administration of the law of Moses among people, that is legislative aspect of it, and anything that is to do with teaching. They are called scribes. They are called the teachers of the law. The Levites are teachers of the law who are supposed to teach the word of God to people. They are the ones who are supposed to regulate following the nation with the law. And whenever there is a problem among people, they are the ones who are appointed as judges among people. They were given high priority by God. They were consecrated by God to do something very important. So if I If I have to simply paint what Matthew was supposed to do as a Levite, is this, that they are supposed to be, as a Levite, they are supposed to be dedicated to the service of God. They're supposed to be in the service of God. The temple, anything to do with the temple, they were supposed to be the preacher, singers, they were supposed to be the musicians, they were supposed to be the production guys, they were supposed to be the door people, they were supposed to, you know, the hosts, all that stuff. They were supposed to be the guys who would do all that when it comes to spiritual aspect of it. And then outside of the temple, they are supposed to be the ones who teach the gospel, teach the law of God to people in their communities. They are supposed to be the ones who are copying the Torah so that future generations can get copies of it. Scribes. They were dedicated to be in the service of God. In one word, they were consecrated to God by God. And because they are consecrated to God by God, they are expected to be holy. They're called to be holy people. They're called to be people whose character is very upright, whose lives are upright. They are living a life of righteousness because they're supposed to be modeling it to people, right? So they were supposed to be that, Levites. Live a life that is different from everybody else so others can see righteousness of God through their lives and learn from them and live their lives too according to the word of God. And then, of course, they were responsible for the well-being of Jews. As I told you, they are the ones who are supposed to teach people, represent God to people and people to God. They were supposed, by making sure proper laws are implemented, by making sure proper judicial system is taking place, they were supposed to be the people who were in the service of people. That was what Matthew was called to be. But Matthew is a tax collector. He did exactly opposite to that. He picked up a profession that is in direct opposition to what he was dedicated for. Matthew, the Levite, I don't know if he's a priest. I don't know if he's from Aaronic priestly family. If he's a priest, it's even worse thing to do what he's doing. He picked up a job that is in complete opposition to what he was called to do. Then, because of that job, he became corrupted in his character. And because of his corruption in his character, he became irresponsible towards the well-being of people. I just painted the picture of what tax collectors were in those days. Imagine the kind of atrocities Matthew would have committed against people as a tax collector. Christian. He's supposed to be a Christian. In our language, he's supposed to be a Christian. Who is to be in the service of God. Who's supposed to live his life in such a way that others would see he's different from everybody else. His character should have been impeccable. Now, I know we cannot be perfect, and I'll talk about perfection 2 days from now. But he's supposed to at least pursue to be a holy person. But he let the system corrupt him, corrupt his character. We do that. A lot of us as Christians, we let the system corrupt us. And then we blame the system. We blame our neighbors. We blame the community around us for the corruption that we carry in our lives, for the compromise that we made. We kind of throw excuses on somebody else. When we were supposed to be the people who are responsible for the well-being of somebody else, and God called us to be responsible for the well-being of others. That's why Jesus said, go and preach the gospel all over the world. Because just like how you have experienced and I have experienced salvation, those who do not know Christ must experience salvation. So he called us to do that. So when you forsake your calling, compromise with the system, your character becomes corrupt and your faith becomes colder. And you backslide in your Christian life. Matthew is an example of a backsliding Christian. But the grace of God is such that God won't leave us like that. A grace of God is a restoring grace of God. Do you know why I know for sure Matthew is a backsliding Jew? As a Jew, represents backsliding Christians like us. Not us right now, but those who are backsliding. It's because Matthew writes one thing that the other two gospel writers don't write. You remember Pharisees and teachers of the law came to Matthew's house. Maybe they didn't enter Matthew's house. They were standing outside and they were talking. Obviously, wherever Jesus went, there was a lot of crowd and people would come and gather around Jesus. And these Pharisees and tax collectors came and saw that Jesus was sitting with tax collectors and sinners. They call them scum of the society. Scum of the society. That's what they use the word. Jesus is sitting with scum and tax collectors. How can he sit like that? Jesus looks back and what he answered, we know, verses 31 and 32, says, Jesus says, only the sick person requires a doctor, not a healthy one. Only I came to save the sinner who knows that he is in need of salvation. I like the way Jesus phrased what he said. He did not say, I did not come to save righteous people, but I came to save sinners. He did not say that. Look at what he said. He says, I came to save those who know that they are sinners, not those who think that they are righteous. I love it. Look at the wordplay of Jesus. Basically, he's saying all of you are sinners. That's what he's saying. You think you are righteous, but you are not. But at least those who know that they are sinful, I came for them. Those who know that they are in need of salvation, I came for them. Mark and Luke write that exact statement. But Matthew adds another one in the middle. And that's how I know Matthew is somebody who experienced the restoring grace of God. Look at what he says in Matthew chapter 9, verses 13. He says, what Jesus said there. Jesus said, I desire compassion, not sacrifice. I desire compassion, not sacrifice. He said exactly the same thing. Only a sick person requires doctor, not the healthy one. Only a sinner requires me, not the righteous one. Then he says, I wish you had studied what it means. I desire compassion. Now you see what I'm saying. Only a person who experienced the compassion of God would write something like that. Nobody else remembered that. Matthew remembers that. Why? Because he experienced that. Compassion. In our another word for compassion is mercy. Matthew experienced mercy of God at the table. The compassion of God at the table. God has every right to be angry with Matthew. Matthew the Levite. Matthew the priest, if he was a priestly family, if he's coming from a priestly family. Because God explicitly gave rules and regulations to Levites. Ordinary people may not understand. Levites are supposed to understand. They're supposed to be scholars. Matthew is an educated man. He knows the word of God. He knows the Torah by heart. He knows the prophetic word by heart. How do I know that? Look at Matthew's gospel. Look at the times he keeps bringing up the Old Testament in his own gospel. Only a person who understands, who already is educated in the Old Testament, can write a gospel like that. So Matthew knows what is right and what is wrong. Matthew knows what is the will of God and what is not the will of God. And yet he deliberately disobeyed and walked away from what he is called to be. That's why he represents a backsliding Christian. A person who knows what is right and does not do what is right, we never forgive a person like that. Look at how we distribute forgiveness, right? The way we forgive people. If you don't know, okay, chalo. If the circumstance caused you to do, no problem. But we don't actually take people lightly, those who deliberately disobey what you tell them. You know what is right, and yet you did that. I'll not offer you forgiveness. But the compassion of God, the grace of God is such that just like how he forgives those who do not know what is the difference between what is right and wrong, just like how he forgives them, he also forgives them those who know what is right and deliberately broke it. Now such kind of grace is incomprehensible. We cannot understand that kind of grace. We kind of wonder, how can God do that? Now, there are a lot of people who wondered at one of the parables that Jesus talked about, how that God represents a man who went out in the morning to the marketplace, saw a few people who were looking for labor and asked them, can you come and work in my field for harvesting? I'll pay you so much. Then he goes out at 12 o'clock in the afternoon and finds more people waiting to get a job and calls them to his fields and asks them to work and says, I promise you to give this much. Then he goes at 3 o'clock in the evening and then go at 5 o'clock in the evening. After everybody worked and all of them lined up, they saw that the master was paying exactly the same amount that he was paying to the people who worked from morning to the evening, and those who joined at 5 o'clock, he's paying the same amount of money. So those who came in the morning said, this is unjust. A lot of us Christians, we behave like that. This is unjust. You can't do like that. This fellow came at 5 o'clock. I came at morning 9 a.m. and I'm working all day. You can't pay me the same amount. You have to give me bonus. Exactly, that's what they demanded him. The master looks at him and says something very important. In fact, I will explain that in a moment from now. Master looks at them and says, listen, what is it to you? Did I give you what I promised you? Yes, master. Then what's your problem if I give to this fellow? If I did not give what I promised you in the morning, then you can call it unjust. Who are you to tell me what I need to do with people? That's why none of us can complain about the grace of God that God shows to those who we think undeserving. Does it make sense? That's how restoring grace of God works. No wonder Matthew remembers that. I desire compassion, not sacrifice. Why? Why does God offer restoring grace? It's a very important question. We all need to know, those of us who are backsliding, those of us who are struggling in our faith, those of us who may feel, I did something wrong, I don't know if God is going to forgive me. The good news is this, God is so gracious that he is willing to restore us. Why? Why does he do that? Some of us who have a question about the grace, some of us who are looking for the grace, both of us need this answer. Let me give you four reasons why God shows restoring grace. Number one, because God's love is unconditional. God's love is unconditional. There are no conditions for God's love. His love does not increase and decrease. His love is not affected by our lives, our actions, our circumstances. Our love gets affected by others' actions towards us. God's love is unconditional. When God says, for God so loved the world, he loved the world. End of story. Now, I'm not asking you to abuse that love. I'm simply saying, that's the character of God. God simply loves people. His love is unconditional. He doesn't say, I love you if. Or he doesn't say, I love you because. We sang a beautiful song called Give Thanks. None of us would have given thanks if God did not give us what we have today. We wouldn't have sung that song. We all need a reason. We all need something in exchange for what we give to somebody else. That's how we behave with God too. God is not like that. When he says, I love man, he loves man. There are no ifs and becauses. God's love is in spite of. In spite of. He never stops loving us. I wrote it down in my diary 2 years ago. God will never stop loving me. God will never stop loving me. People may stop loving me, but God will never stop loving me. The more I think about it, the more I write it down on my heart, the more I'm hopeful that today I may be bad, but tomorrow I can get better. Today I may be struggling in my faith life, but tomorrow I'll become more, better, stronger in my faith, because God never stops loving me. See, God's love is unconditional. In Lamentations chapter 3, verses 22, Jeremiah sings this: God's compassion never ends. It is, his love is so good. It never stops. Never stops. Underline that word, never. God never stops loving you. The second reason why God's grace is a restoring grace is because forgiveness is God's prerogative. It's a very important statement for all Christians to remember. Forgiveness is God's prerogative. We don't decide who God should forgive and who God should not forgive. Remember that. That's why I told you the parable. I think I jumped ahead with regards to the parable. The parable fits in this exactly. We don't decide how God should treat people. Our faith should not depend on how God treats other people. Our faith should depend on how God shows his grace to us. That's it. Nothing more than that. When a Christian struggles understanding that aspect of God's forgiveness and grace, he will struggle with accepting other people. He will struggle with offering grace to others. He will become bitter against God. God's forgiveness is God's prerogative. Don't change that. Paul says in Romans chapter 9, verse 16, it doesn't depend on man's desire or effort, but only on God's mercy. What? The salvation of man. Romans chapter 9, verse 16. It's as if Paul repeats it to Titus one more time, because he kind of, I guess he's a good teacher, he kind of understands people don't understand one time. Let me repeat it one more time. In Titus chapter 3, verse 5, he says, he saved us not because of the good things that we have done. Not because of our deserving, but because of his mercy. That's it. Forgiveness is God's prerogative. That's why God restores people like Matthew. God restores people like me. God restores people like you. Because that's his prerogative. We can't question that. Number three, the third reason why God offers forgiveness and why restoring grace is such a wonderful one is because God understands human weakness. God understands our weaknesses. He understands we are only feeble people. We are flawed people. He knows that we are not perfect people. Until we get to be with him in heaven, we would not be perfect. We will struggle with our emotions. We will struggle with our weaknesses. And in our weaknesses, we stumble. God understands that. Hebrews chapter 4, verses 15 says, we have a high priest who sympathizes with us because he knows human weaknesses. He has gone through every experience that you and I have gone through. And yet he became victorious. In verses 16, he goes on to say, because he has become victorious over the sin, he is in a better position to offer us wisdom In fact, the actual word is common sense. Did you know? I like it in Telugu. Just samayochitamaina alochana. On time, common sense. We call it common sense. God gives us common sense to overcome the temptation that we face because He already faced it. That's why don't be afraid to approach Him. What a word it is, huh? So He understands our weakness. He understands that there will be times and circumstances where, because of our weakness, we would fail in our faith walk. And then, of course, number four, God doesn't hold grudges. He's not like us. We hold grudges. God's not like that. I'm glad God is not like that. Pray that God remains like that. Because if God is somebody who is going to hold grudges, you and I would be vanishing from this earth just like that. God doesn't hold grudges. He's not going to talk to us 1 year from now, reminding us about 1947. In 1947, August 24th, you did like this. He won't say that. In fact, He says, once I have forgiven you, I have forgotten it. Not like God cannot forget. Of course we know that. What He means is, I'll never remind you again. Only Satan reminds us of our past. Remember that. When somebody reminds you of your past, they are not prophetic people. Don't fall into that trap. God doesn't remind you of your past. He doesn't put you to shame. If He wanted to put you to shame, He wouldn't have sent His Son to die. He sent His Son to die so that you and I will never be put to shame by Him. He allowed His Son to be shamed so that we would not face that kind of shame. Only Satan shames us. I'm glad God doesn't hold grudges. Psalm 103 beautifully portrays that. David says, my God is compassionate. He's so compassionate that He doesn't deal with me as I deserve. He doesn't deal with me as I deserve. What He's saying is, the things that I've done, I deserve to be punished. But God doesn't take revenge on me. He's slow to anger and quick to show compassion. Like a father who is quick to come forgive his son, my God is quick to forgive my sin. Now, this is not a license to sin. Of course, my intention is never to give you permission to go on living as you want. My intention is to show you the wonderful grace of God, the restoring grace of God. If you truly experience it, you would not go back to sin again. You wouldn't want to go back there. You would enjoy this grace, this wonderful grace. And you will allow this grace to keep changing you every day. You will become more intentional in asking God, God, can you help me not to think like this? Can you help me not to say things like this? You may not do that overnight. You may not become perfect. But you will begin to talk to God, asking Him, can you help me to become more and more like you, God? You will intentionally begin to live your life like that, behave like that. You will fail. You and I, after all, we are human beings and we have weaknesses. But then you will overcome your weakness. You'll be quick to recognize your weakness because of the restoring grace of God. That's why a lot of Christians who fell, got up, and walked again. Unlike a lot of other Christians who fell and decided to sit down. You don't have to be a Christian today, a person who sits down. Now you could be looking at me and say, but you don't know the kind of things that I've done. Of course I don't know. But God knows, right? And yet God is speaking to you and He's saying, I will restore you. That's what God is saying. I don't know. What does it matter if I know or not? You know and God knows. That's all it matters. It could be a major sin or it could be a minor sin. Sin anyway separates us from God. major or minor. God says, whether it is a major or minor sin, I'm still going to give you another chance. Still going to offer forgiveness to you. You know, the reason many of us give up on Christian walk and our faith is because we somehow have a wrong understanding between a fellowship and relationship. Let me explain that. And then I'll close with a simple thought. We are in relationship with God. Like how me and Janet are married, we are in a relationship. And we both have children. We father Hosea and Salome. They're our children. This is our relationship. It doesn't change. The moment they were born through us, they became our children. It's a relationship that is established. That relationship can never be broken. I'm sure Hosea and Jeannie would not leave us. But should they decide to disobey us, rebel against us, and walk away from us, never talk to us again in life, our fellowship gets broken. But they will always be our children. And we will always be their parents. The moment you have accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you entered into a relationship with God. You remember the words that Jesus says? Everyone who accepts Jesus, the Son, they are called to be children of God. That means you have the moment you have accepted Christ, you have become a child of God. You entered into a relationship with your Father. Now you are the child of God. That relationship would never go away. You may not have a fellowship. You may, because of your own laziness, overconfidence, or many other reasons, may break the relationship, fellowship with God. But you're always going to remain a child of God. God never forgets that. That's why, like a father, like the shepherd who would go and search for the lost one, the Father will continue to go and search for you. Continue to wait for you to return. So that when you do come, he would simply take you back into fellowship. We need to understand, Christians must understand the difference between fellowship and relationship. That's why the restoring grace of God works. All Jesus did to Matthew is simply to show, listen, Matthew, I know you broke all rules. But that doesn't change the fact that I consecrated you to be my servant. No wonder Paul says the calling of God can never be revoked. Once God places his hand on you, it cannot be revoked. It just stays like that. Till you take your last breath here on earth, you still have an opportunity to come back. When we sin, we don't lose our relationship with God. As a Christian, we lose our fellowship with God. And losing the fellowship with God can actually make us suffer a lot. We lose a lot of blessings, the joy of salvation. We lose all that. Peace of God. We lose all that. Definitely. But not the relationship that we have with God. Until we take last breath here on earth. So God never stops loving us, he never stops giving us an opportunity to be restored back to him. How does God restore us when we return? He will take us back just as he took us the first time we came to him. Do you know, in Isaiah chapter 54, there's a wonderful verse. He's talking to similar kind of people and he says, listen, return to me. With great compassion, I'll take you back. With great compassion, I'll take you back. Like a father who would just hug his son, I would hug you back. That's what he's saying. Return to me, I'll take you back. So he would definitely take you back and accept you. Just like how he accepted you the first time, he would accept you even now. Then, not just he won't leave us like that, he would restore the joy of salvation back. Remember the day you have accepted Christ. The day you really accepted Christ. That day was a day that you thought you conquered the world. That was the day you thought nobody can defeat me. I don't care what anybody thinks about me. Now I know God loves me. That day, the joy that filled your heart, that made you careless. Not in the wrong sense, but the careless in the sense of, like, I'm happy. That joy. No wonder David looks at God in Psalm 51 and says, God, restore the joy of my salvation. After he sinned with Bathsheba, that's what his prayer was. God, I know I sinned against you, but would you restore the joy of my salvation? The grace of God is such that not only he take you back and accept you, he will restore the joy of his salvation. But here is the most important thing. And I love it when he talks the same thing in Jeremiah chapter 15, verses 19. If you return to me, he's talking to the same kind of people, okay? So whether it is Psalmist, Psalm 51, or Isaiah in chapter 54, or Jeremiah in chapter 15, he's talking to the same group of people, backsliding people. Okay? So God is saying to his people, if you return to me, I will restore you so you can continue to serve me. Meaning, he gives his calling back. That's what he did with Matthew. Matthew, you are supposed to serve me. As a Levite, your job was to serve me. So let me restore the job back to you. Become my disciple and become a world changer. What a joy, huh? What a grace of God. Peter understands how it works. Very subtly, in Mark chapter 16, verses 7, very subtly, in one single statement, the angel talks about the restoring grace of God. That day on the Easter morning when Mary Magdalene and other Mary and Salome went to visit Jesus and found that Jesus already rose from the dead and they were worried that the angel is talking to them and he's saying, he's risen, he's not here. Go and tell it to disciples and Peter. Just 3 days before, the same Peter who said, I will never deny God, I will die for God, was the one who was standing in right in front of the eyes of Jesus and say, I don't know Jesus. Not one time, 3 times. Not in front of a Roman governor, not in front of Sanhedrin, just in front of a maid. He couldn't even stand up to a maid and say, I'm a Christian. He failed Jesus so miserably. But Jesus said something to Peter on the day, again at the table, on the Last Supper table, he was sitting with Peter and he's saying, Peter, you say you're going to die for me, you're going to deny me today. Oh, yeah, how much he, Peter, would have gotten hurt, no? You're going to deny me. But don't worry, Peter. That's what Jesus said. Don't worry, Peter. I prayed for you. I prayed for you. When you get restored, this is Jesus saying to Peter, when you get restored, come and strengthen your brothers. You will experience the restoration. You will experience the grace of God that has this power to restore your life. When that happens to you, go back. Talk to the people who are also broken like you, backslidden like you, and tell them, don't worry, God restores us. 3 days from then, Peter experienced that restoring grace of God. The angel could have said, just go and tell disciples. Of course, Peter is also one of the disciples, right? And yet the angel, it's almost as if the entire heaven is waiting for Peter to be restored. Angel looks at, there's Mary and Salome, whoever were there. Go and tell disciples and tell Peter specifically, go and tell this fellow. I know he's depressed. I know he's given up on his faith. I know he's hiding inside his bedroom. Go and tell him that God has forgiven him. What a day of restoration. Peter understood that, experienced that, and grabbed it. And then he truly became a world changer. He lost his calling, got his calling back. Lost his perspective, got his perspective back. Lost his faith, got his faith back. Not because he did something, but because God showed grace. May God, as he offers his grace to you, may you accept it, grab it by both your hands, and be restored by him. Irrespective of how far you have gone, God still restores us today. Let's close our eyes. The Passion Week is all about the grace of God. How the grace of God saves us, but not just save us, when we fail, how the grace of God restores us. So let me take a moment to give, to pray together. I want to ask you to pray for yourself and offer yourselves to our Lord. Some of us may not need that. We're already walking in a living relationship with him, fellowship with him. But sometimes we may be confused about the grace of God that he's offered to people who we consider are unworthy, we consider are not the kind of people who should be forgiven. And yet today, God speaks to us and says, listen, forgiveness is my prerogative. Compassion is my prerogative. Just like how much I love you, I love this person who has backslidden. Just like how I showed compassion over you, I want to show compassion over them. May we understand that grace of God, and enjoy that grace. Give thanks to him for that kind of grace. For those of us who are backsliding or struggling in our faith, today you heard God has not given up on you. He will never give up on you. He never stopped loving you. And he will never stop in the future too. He never stopped, neither will he ever stop. So in the light of that knowledge, offer your life back to him. The restoring grace of God is being offered to you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Before we pray together, can we take a moment to worship our God together with our worship team and just in our worship express our gratitude to our God? Just for a couple of minutes. I know you want to get back home, but I just want to give this time to worship him. Would you like to stand to your feet and worship him together? Thank you, Jesus.
You are filled with compassion and mercy and grace. With your banner of love over me, I am longing to see you one day face to face, and to be with you endlessly. Lord, how lovely you are to me. Oh, you are filled with compassion and mercy and grace. With your banner of love over me, I am longing to see you one day face to face, and to be with you endlessly. Lord, how lovely you are to me. Lovely Lord, you are all to me. Lovely Lord, full of purity, worthy of honor.
lovely you are to me.
Lovely Lord, lovely Lord,
you are all to me.
Lovely Lord,
full of purity, worthy of honor and majesty. Lord, how lovely you are to me. Lord, how lovely you are to me.
Holy God, your love, this unconditional love that is showered upon us is wonderful. We all stand together and worship you, giving thanks to you in gratitude. We thank you for the grace. Wonderful grace it is, God. And I pray that as you revealed this restoring grace that you shower upon our lives, may we enjoy that. Live our lives confidently from this moment. That with all our flaws and faults, there may be times that we may fall, but you would not give up on us. That you would come searching for us, and if we ask you, you would help us to get back. Like how you did with Matthew and how you did with Peter. May we bask under the beauty of restoring grace of God. Thank you for everyone who chose to listen to your voice here in this place and those who were online with us. If somebody needed to hear this, would you begin your transforming work in their lives? Would you begin the restoration process if they returned to you as you promised? Thank you, God, for today. As we go back to our home, give us good night's rest. May this word continue to work in our lives. And God, as you give us an opportunity when we gather again tomorrow, would you continue to speak to us? And if there are people who are hurt, can you speak to us how you would heal us? The healing grace of God. Tomorrow, as we pay attention to you, we pray that God, our lives would be touched and healed. Thank you for those who joined us today. Give them safe journey back home. May your presence continue to be with them. Bless you, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you very much for joining us this evening. We'll see you tomorrow evening at 7. Tomorrow we'll talk about another table which Jesus spread, and we'll talk about how God's grace heals us. As I told you, all of us have a lot of hurts in our lives. How God's grace works in bringing healing to us. We'll talk about it tomorrow. All right, God bless you. Have a wonderful night. Sleep well in restoring grace of God.